I joined Baird the same year that he gave his first demonstration. I was his first engineer, and I was constructing amplifiers and other equipment that he required. He wouldn't tell me anything what he was doing, except I knew he was working on television. He wouldn't show me any of his equipment, and he certainly wouldn't allow me in where the transmitting equipment was. But eventually he had to let me in, and this is what I saw. A large transmitting disc with a series of lenses in a spiral, a photoelectric cell contained in this box, a series of amplifiers, a neon lamp, and a smaller disc with pinholes in the same order that the lenses were on the large transmitting disc. These discs revolved at a tremendous speed. The dummy, the other side of the wall, is viewed by the photocell through the lenses. When the photocell in here sees a bright part of the face, it produces a lot of electricity. A dark part of the face, a smaller amount of electricity. These electrical impulses are amplified by these amplifiers and put onto the neon lamp here, which varies in brightness according to the light or dark part of the image that is being looked at by the photoelectric cell here. These image then on the neon lamp is looked at through the pinholes in this disc and viewed from the other side. These lenses, being mounted as a spiral, scan. The first lens scans the one strip of the face, the second lens is the adjoining strip, and so on until the whole face has been covered. The purpose of the pinhole disc is to reassemble those strips in their correct order as seen from the other side of the wall by anybody looking in. Later on, this receiving part of the equipment could be miles away in a viewer's home, then be necessary for the two discs to be run in absolute synchronism. Otherwise, the face would be assembled in its wrong order. That can't happen here because these two discs are mounted on the same shaft as they were in Baird's original equipment, and this is how it ran. There was nothing new in this sort of thing. People had been talking about it for the last 50 years. But my old boss, Logie Baird, was the first one to make it work, and he did it entirely by himself.
And I used the picture signals from C.O. Brown's film scanning equipment to test our cathode ray tubes. And we quickly came to the conclusion that they produce very much better pictures than those produced by any mechanical system. Its steadiness, its silence, and the absence of any moving parts, like whirring discs, were very convincing arguments in its favor. During the summer of 1932, we diverted some of the effort that should have been devoted to ordinary cathode ray tubes to the development of what we hoped would be a television picture transmitting tube. And by that autumn we had it working, and this is it. This is essentially a cathode ray tube, a glass tube from which nearly all the air has been removed to produce a very high vacuum. In this glass extension tube we mount an electron gun which fires a sharply focused beam of electrons at this target. The target takes the place of the fluorescent screen of a conventional cathode ray tube. This device has often been called an electronic eye, and in that analogy, this target is the retina of the eye. It consists of an insulated metal plate, and on the front surface of this we form a very large number of minute globules of silver, which are insulated from one another and are treated in such a way as to be sensitive to light. However, it required several man years of patient investigation before we could understand exactly how it worked and produce this tube, which is the one that was used for the opening of the television service at Alexandra Palace by the BBC in 1936. This tube we had to make in secret because, in fact, the EMI management at that time were not interested in the transmission side of television.
Bernard Greenhead was one of the junior members of the EMI research team.
Mr. Ashbridge and Douglas Birkinshaw came down on several occasions. We had the feeling that we got to impress these people, because the BBC were only customers. Apart from producing pictures from our little studio, we always gave them the famous canal shot. We pointed the camera out of the window, down to the canal, where there was always plenty of contrast and movement. And additionally, the light reflected from the water certainly improved the quality of the picture. I thought Mr. Schoenberg was an excellent salesman. There you are, Mr. Respidge. What do you think? The best pictures in the world.
In the first public experimental television system, which we started in 1932, we used low-definition television. That's to say, we divided the picture into no more than 30 lines. But for modern television, something much better was required, and the Selsdon Committee hoped for not less than 240. The Baird Company offered this figure, but EMI's went as high as 405 lines, which they were quite confident that they could do. And this was a most courageous decision by their television director, Isaac Schoenberg. Also, it was made at a time when they had never created any equipment to exploit this standard. So they had to set to work and do this very quickly, as the Selsdon Committee were expecting results within the year. In the meantime, the BBC set to work to find a site.
The first television station presented many difficulties of which the public know little. Eventually, the Alexandra Palace was chosen. In November 1935, the work of reconstruction was begun on the southeast wing. To convert the old palace into the headquarters of the latest miracle in electrical communication, complete reconstruction was necessary, so that the building might house the transmitters, control rooms, studios, and all the complicated apparatus of the two television systems. The ground floor had to be made solid enough to bed heavy generators and rotary converters, which are part of the transmitting equipment. In the Baird transmitting hall alone, there are 12 heavy motor generators.